You are often defined as a theologian because you have an interest in theology. But you always say, and you write in your book Crossing the Rubicon, that you are first a philosopher. Could you explain to us what your own position is?
So thanks for your question. It's a good question because, in fact, it depends where I am. But for example, where I am in France, people say to me, he's too theologian, he's not a phenomenologist enough. But it depends, because if I go to England or to US, I can say, no, he's not too theologian, he's a true phenomenologist. And we would like that he would become more theologian. For an example, I just finished a book, my last book, Our Phenomenon, The Extra Phenomenon. It is only a phenomenological one. So many people told me in France, now you are a true phenomenologist. But I met so many people from Cambridge, Oxford, anywhere, who told me, you stopped to write some book in theology because you announced that you will write a book on the Holy Saturday. Or in fact, I wrote a paper after. But that's why, for me, I am both philosophian and theologian. I don't want to confuse the discipline, but I study both philosophy and theology. And that's why I was astonished sometimes that when people, for example, priests and so on, studied theology, they never speak about theology. Because we are in France, huh? And today we are in France. You are at the Catholic University of Paris, and thanks to have come here in my university. But in France, of course, you have to be a philosopher among the philosophers. Huh? That's why the first time I met Jean-Luc Marion, who is now a good friend of me, he told me, do like me, advance mask, larvatus pro deo. It is a sentence of Descartes, of the young Descartes. And I respond never, I don't want to advance mask. So I said, I wrote on a paper on Jean-Luc Marion, in my book, The Loving Schrugger, I said, no, I don't advance mask. I am larvatus pro deo, as say Ovid. I advance with the face opened. So it means, perhaps because I'm teaching here at the Catholic University of Paris, it means that, in fact, it's possible for me, because I'm teaching here, to teach both philosophy and theology. But I don't want to confuse the two. And I always write, for example, in my book, You Can Now Crossing the Rubicon, I always write that I am first a philosopher. So what does it mean to be first a philosopher? It means that I begin by the below, not by the up. It means, and that's why I wrote a book with Metamorphosis of Finitude. It means that the finitude is first, our world is first. So what is the difference between philosophy and theology? It is the fact that a philosopher will think in what I call an heuristic way, which is not a didactic way. Because when you are a philosopher, nothing is done at the beginning. It's a difference between a theologian who has the revelation first. So nothing is done. And, for example, if you take, for an example, the Cartesian meditation, no, the meditation, metaphysical meditation of Descartes, you see that what is at the beginning is not the same of what is at the end. Because at the beginning you have the doubt, and then you have the cogito, and then at the sixth meditation, you have the word, the body, and so on. So it means that in philosophy, the beginning is not the same as the first, as the end. And theology is completely different, especially in German theology, because in German theology, it's not the same way, so everything is done at the beginning. So it's absolutely not the same. For me, because I am a philosopher, I'm thinking first in a heuristic way and not in a didactic way. So then, for example, when I speak about finitude, in Metamorphosis of Finitude, the beginning is finitude. I don't speak about revelation. And that's why I try, as a philosopher, to find something in common. I call that l'homme tout court, the human as short. It doesn't mean that there is no God and so on. It means that the believing in God is not our first experience. And we will discover it. Our first experience is our experience of humanity. So we have to discover our humanity first. And I want to underline a very important point for me. It is what Thomas Aquinas did exactly. In fact, when we speak about Thomas Aquinas, we speak about the natural reason, the natural lumen, light of reason, or the natural theology. And we are always thinking in Thomas Aquinas, and now I'm so close of Thomas Aquinas, I was first more Bonaventurian, perhaps now I am more Thomasian. It's not against the two, huh? But what I discover in Thomas Aquinas is the fact that for Thomas Aquinas, the speaking about reason is not only a way to reach God with all my reason. In fact, it is an attempt to try to find something in common. So if I take, for example, the beginning of the Contra Gentiles, for me, it is not a book against the Gentiles, the pagans and the Muslims. It is, for me, a for Gentiles, not a contra, but a for Gentiles. What does it mean? If you take the beginning of this Thomasian book, which was the first one before the Summa Theologiae, nobody's, no Muslims, no pagans read this book. It was a book for the Gentiles, but in fact, it was just a methodological way. But why Thomas Aquinas did that? I think not only to speak about the reason we try to reach God, the natural reason, but to try to find something in common. And he explained at the beginning that if I dialogue with a Jewish, I have something in common. What is in common? It is the Old Testament, or the First Testament, because it's not so good to speak about the Old Testament. Because when you speak with a Jewish about the Old Testament, it means that we have the new one. So I prefer to speak about the First Testament of the Jewish. Okay, so we can speak, as said Thomas Aquinas. And if we speak with the heretics, there is no problem too, because we have the new, or the Second Testament in common. But the question is, but how to speak with the people which we have nothing in common, no scripture. So it's impossible to impose the revelation. And we will see that is the point that I criticize in French theology. As if revelation is given, so you accept it or you see nothing. It means nothing. Because, of course, you can have many friends, children, and so on, who don't believe in God. And you don't have to say first, you have to believe in what I believe, because you have no dialogal situation. So, what Thomas Aquinas is doing? Thomas Aquinas, he said, okay, we have the Old Testament, or the First Testament common with the Jewish. We have the Second Testament, or the New Testament, with the heretic. But we have nothing in common with the pagans and the Muslims. So, we have to try something in common. And what is it? The reason. Because Thomas Aquinas, he took back Aristotle, and the definition of human being in Thomas Aquinas is the human is a reasonable animal. Reason. So the reason is not only the way to reach God for Thomas Aquinas. The reason is the fact to find something in common. Because we have the reason in common with the pagans, we have the reason in common with the Muslims and so on. That's why the beginning of the Contra Gentiles in three parts, there are four parts, but the first three parts, you have God, creation, and providence. It's not scripture. What we have in common. And then the fourth part is revelation. Of course, Thomas Aquinas said the revelation is Christian revelation is the best one, which according to the to the reason. So my question today is, what do we have in common? We have to do, of course, with a lot of humility, but what Thomas Aquinas did. It means that today we can't say that we have in common the reason. Because why? Because we don't live in the Middle Age. And between Thomas and Quinas, we have Freud, we have Nietzsche, we have Auguste Comte, and so on. We are not in the same time. So what do we have in common? And for example, if you read Michel Foucault, in his book, Les mots et les choses, the things and the words, I don't know the translation in English, excuse me, at the end of the book, which is a big one, he explained in an analytical of finitude that finitude is today the word, the name of human being in our time. So what is the name of human being in our time? As said Foucault, he said, in our time, the name of human being is a figure of finitude. So what does that mean, finitude, this concept of finitude? This concept is, for me, very important one. And it is a point where, because when you ask a question, where there is a difference between philosophy and theology. Why? Because in my mind, and because I am both philosopher and theologian, but I studied first philosophy. In my mind, it's not only in my mind, it is also in the Heideggerian mind, to mind too, finitude is not the same as the finite. Why? Heidegger explained just after he wrote Began Time. He gave a course, which is a Kant book, Kant and the Problem of Metaphysics, and in this text, at the beginning, Heidegger said, we can't identify the finitude to the finite. Why? Because when you speak about the finite, you presuppose a form on the infinite. It means that you said, I am finite. So you regret to be finite. I say, I have finite, I create finite, but I'm not infinite. Exactly as said Descartes. Because Descartes, he explained that we are finite in the entendement, in our mind, but we are infinite in our will. So, and the mistake is the fact of there is an excess of the will on the suit. Okay, but in fact, infinitude, you have no contrary. Infinitude, it does not exist. What is finitude? It is the horizon of my existence. So when you work, okay, you have an horizon, but there is always a limit. There is always a limit. And the limit is good. Exactly what Thomas Aquinas, in my mind, discovered. The limit is good. Because Thomas Aquinas said, we are created as limited. So we don't have to regret to not be illimitate. And in fact, it is the temptation, it is that. Because what the snake is saying to Adam, he's saying, and Eva, if you eat of the tree of the good and evil, you will be as gods. You will be illimitated. So in fact, illimitation is a temptation. So it is absolutely the inverse of what we are always thinking about, because we are always thinking that first we are illimitated, or it should be so good to be illimitated, then we fall sometimes in creation and we became limited, and then when we will resurrect, we will be illimited again. Absolutely not what Thomas Aquinas said, or the theology, because as Thomas Aquinas said, in the resurrection, we will be always limited, created, we are creature, and God will resplendish through our limitation. So we have to distinguish, as we have to distinguish between finitude and finite, we have to distinguish between limit and limitation. And the point I contest in theology, it is the fact that all the theologians, where they speak about finite, finitude, in fact, they speak about finite, because you have this concept of limitation. And in fact, we are not in a limitation. We are created in our limits. There is a very interesting text, not very well known, on Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who gave a course on Genesis just before the war. It was in 1936. And I explained that God, Adam, has been created in the limits. That's why there is a tree at the center of the garden in Eden, because the tree of the evil, the good and the evil, it is a limit. Here is the limit, so you can eat what you want, except that, because you need a limit. Exactly with the children, I have four children, grandchildren, and you have to say to the children, hey, I give you a limit, you can do, because if you have no limits, you do anything, it's anarchia. So he gave a limit. But it was so difficult, it is so difficult for Adam to accept to be created and not uncreated, like God. That, as said Dietrich Bonhoeffer, God gave to Adam Eva. And who is Eva? Eva is the limit of Adam, not a limitation because she's different. And as said Dietrich Bonhoeffer, God gave Eva to Adam to love its own limits. And for me, it's a very nice definition of loving, which is not only to fusion and so on. It means that we live in limits, and the message of Christianity is to say that creation is good, but if creation is good, our limit is good, but if our limit is good, it's not a limitation. So the finitude is not a part of the infinite, and that's why at the beginning of my book in the Triduum Philosophicum, on my book The Metamorphosis of Finitude, I explain that all the French philologists are Cartesian. So it's a bit hard, severe. But why I say that? Because in fact, for me, they are all who I speak about. I spoke about my fathers. My fathers, Jean-Luc Marion, Lévinas, Jean-Luc Chrétien, Michel Henry, Ricoeur. I met Ricoeur, I met Henry, I know Marion, and so on. But in this generation, in a certain manner, they are all Cartesian. They are all thinking, if I quote Descartes, I have first in my mind the idea of the infinite more than the idea of the finite. But it is exactly what Heidegger criticized, so it doesn't mean that I am a complete Heideggerian, absolutely not. But I think that what Heidegger said about the anguish of death, what Heidegger said about finitude, is exactly what characterize the human being today. In other words, to explain this point, which is so important for me. In fact, the Christian people are often thinking, I was thinking that before, that one of my brother, who is absolutely not a believer, told me, why are you always thinking that if I don't believe in what you believe, there is no sense or no meaning in my life? And he told me, listen to that, there is a meaning of my life because I will die and because I will be nothing after my death. So I thought about that, which is exactly what Heidegger said. Because the first book I wrote, which is The Guide to Gethsemane, which is a philosophical interpretation of the Holy Friday, it began from a personal experience, and all my books are coming from my personal experience. There is no philosophy for me outside of life. Philosophy is not only reading books. The books are a translation of what we are in our unity of life. In this book, so at this moment, this book, The Guide of Gethsemane, has been dedicated to two friends, and one has been suicided, and the other one died in a car accident. And at this moment, it is a long time ago, I was reading Heidegger. And I believe more in Heidegger and being in time than in the Godspell. Because it was absolutely right, the anguish of death, it was absolutely right. I was in the anguish of death. But Heidegger said in a note, I remember, I think it's a note of a paragraph 43, something like that, about death, he said, the Christian, the believer, cannot understand what the anguish of death means because he is always seeing the death in the light of resurrection. Look, for Heidegger, death is not death. Of course, you can test the death. It is like a word with works. Okay. And there's works. So I will do a detour and we'll find something. But death is a true death. And the very important point I want to underline when I spoke about my brother is to say that many people today, and perhaps you have friends like that, sons, daughters, and many people, many students in this university where you are, the Catholic University of Paris. In fact, what do they feel? They say, okay, I know that I will die. And perhaps they know more than our generation that I will die because of the crisis, the climate crisis. So I know, but now I am in life. So what do I have to do until I will die? So you understand that today we can say that there is a sense, a meaning in life, not because there is something after this life, but because there is nothing. So you say, how that is possible? But we have to understand, if we are believers, and I am, I never did it. But if we have to understand, if we are believers, that we have to find something in common with the non-believer. That is the meaning of the drama, because there is a chapter, you see that, there's a chapter in Metamorphosis of Finitude, the chapter 3, with many questions, and the question of the entitled of this chapter, it is there a drama of human atheism? So, behind that, there is the Lubac. So many people read the text and said, oh, Falk is against the Lubac. Because I said there is no drama, or no complete drama. So I do not critique the fact that today the people are atheistic, or we are in form of agnosticism, and so on. So I absolutely agree with that point. But I just want to say that what Henri de Lubac did, we have first to do it today. It means to discuss, to dialogue, with the people who don't think like us. In fact, just after the war, in 1945, and then the second publication in 1950, de Lubac, he said, so we have to dialogue with Nietzsche, we have to dialogue with Freud, we have to dialogue with Auguste Comte, so we have to dialogue with nihilism, we have to dialogue with psychoanalysis, we have to dialogue with positivism. But he said, it's a drama. So he did a bit like Thomas Aquinas, because Thomas Aquinas is contra gentiles. So I'll tell you, I'm not contra. So it means for me, it's not only a drama, we have to understand how is it possible to have meaning in my life if I am a human a short, what I call in français, un homme tout court. Okay, then, if I am a believer, something happened. But it's not my idea. It is the idea of God. You ask me if I am first a philosopher or if I am first a theologian. I respond, I am first a philosopher. And as a philosopher, death is finished. It doesn't mean that there is no meaning in my life. But then something happened in God, and it is because something happened in God, and because the Father changed the structure of the world in his Son, as said Saint Paul, from the incorruptible, for the corruptible, we became incorruptible, metamorphosis of finitude, that something else is proposed, is suggested to the believers.
In your book, Crossing the Rubicon, you distinguish between three types of hermeneutics: a Jewish hermeneutics, represented by Levinas, a Protestant hermeneutics, associated with Ricoeur, and a Catholic hermeneutics, represented in your own work. Could you tell us a bit more about this? Is it for or against an ecumenical position in philosophy of religion?
Thanks for your question. It is an important question because, of course, when you speak about Jewish hermeneutic and the Protestant hermeneutics and the Catholic one, it seems that you are very Catholic and perhaps against the Protestant and so on. So it is absolutely not my case. I have been in an ecumenical community. So for me, I completely ecumenical. There is absolutely no problem on that point. The godfather of my daughter is a Protestant pastor in Switzerland. So there is no problem on that point. And when I've been to US or to England, it's absolutely not the same than to speak about a Jewish, a Protestant, and a Catholic hermeneutic. It could be an Anglican one, I don't know. It's not the same situation as if you were you are in France. Because in France, there are not many Catholics. But if you are a believer, you are Catholics. There are so few Protestants. That's why I often say Paul Ricoeur, I knew him very well at the end of his life, I say Paul Ricoeur is the only Protestant in France. It means the only one. It means that the Protestants are about 3% of the believers in France. So the Catholicism is very standard. Perhaps it is the same for Anglicanism in England. But you see, it depends on the story of the tradition. But why I ask this question, what is a Catholic hermeneutic? I remember, it's a story, but I can speak about the stories. When I've been for the first time to the Castelli Conference, which is a very well-known conference in Rome, I was a bit young, and where I met Ricoeur, Henri, and so on. I said, when will we stop to Christianize Levinas, and to Catholicize Ricoeur. Because when you speak about Levinas, you speak about the face of the other. And if you are a believer, you said by the face of the other, it is the sacrament of the brother. But it is absolutely not that in Levinas. Because in Levinas, the other is not an icon. He said it. In one of his texts, which is The Trace, he said the other is not an icon. It is a trace. It means because he's Jewish. Doc Levinas never said that the other is the icon of God. It is a trace. So that is an example. And what I was so surprised when I arrived at the Catholic University of Paris, which is very Ricoeurian, it is very well known, but it is a Catholic university. So, and the hermeneutic, the hermeneutics theology have been a lot of developed here. It was the fact that we were always speaking about the text. Then I thought in myself, is it possible to speak so much about the text? If we are Catholic, is the text first? So I think that if we think about the force sense or meaning of scripture, you know, you have the literal one, you have the tropological or the moral one, you have the allegoric one and the anagogic one, you know that, of course. And for me, and what I explained at the beginning of Crossing the Rubicon, is the fact that during the period of the historical critical exegesis, lot of developed here in Catholic, which is very important, what do we have to do? We have to be very savant, cut the text, and to say, okay, I know that now there is a Yavist tradition, a sacerdotal tradition. So everything was based on the referent. So the Ricoeurian reaction, which was a good one, was to say, no, the question is not to read the text relatively to its referent, but there is a meaning in the text itself. As said Ricoeur, we can read the two story of creation in the Genesis as if it was one. So it has been very important, and very important for the pastoral, for the church, because it was possible to read the text and to say, the text is addressed to me. That's not the same. Huh? If you are a believer, it's not the same to say that the text is addressed to me, that to say that the text is has to be read relatively to a referent, to an historicity. It doesn't mean that the history doesn't mind, but it means that the text has to speak to me. Exactly, for example, for the spiritual exercise of Ignatius of Loyola, and it is a question to say to you that me, I'm very Ignatian. I did the 30 days in silence, so it's me an experience, and I am Franciscan too. I rest I am Ignatian and Franciscan because I live a very important conversion when I was 17, a long time ago, and it was in Assisi. Perhaps why I did my PhD and my book on Bonaventure. So Ignaz de Loyola and Bonaventure, I'm two pillars for my suit. So, and in Ignatius, the question is absolutely not to refer the text to an history, but how the text is speaking to yourself in your affectivity and so on. So that is a very important point. That's why Ricoeur has been a sort of liberation, I can say, because, but an attempt, not perhaps of Ricoeur, but of the people who used Ricoeur, and perhaps the theologian too sometimes, is to say, okay, the most important point is the appropriation of the text, for the text is speaking to me. It means that the Bible is for me. It is a point I criticate, because I think absolutely the inverse, what I call not the hermeneutical reading of Bible, but the phonological reading of Bible. And what is a phonological reading of Bible? It means that the text is not made for me, but I am made for the text. Exactly was said, in fact, to Paul Claudel in his fantastic text, I Love Bible, J'aime la Bible. It means that I have to be lost in the text and not to discover myself in the text. In that way, for me, the period of the historical critical exegesis is the literal sense. The period of rigor of the appropriation of the text is the moral or topological sense, meaning, because the text is made for me, but me, I revendicate the allegorical and anagogical sense. It means that the text, I have to find the figure of the Christ in the text, which is allegorical, and for the prior. So, in fact, I think that now we can't repeat always the theological hermeneutics, because we do it for 30 years, and we did it for the historical exegesis. So that is the first point I wanted to say, and which is in Crossing the Rubicon. The second point, you asked me, you are right. You said, okay, you speak about the three forms of hermeneutics, Jewish, Protestant, and Catholic. Is it against economism? Economical? Is it really economical? I said to you that I am completely economical, but we have to find each tradition and to develop in each tradition its specificity. So, what is the specificity of the Jewish hermeneutics? For me, in Levinas, and he always said it. In fact, his philosophy is rooted in the Jewish confession. I said I want to translate the Bible in Greek, so it's clear. And in this Jewish confession, the text is very important. But it's not the meaning of the text. It is the body of the text, because of the tabernacle, because of the law, of the Deuteronomium and Moïse, and so on. So what I call the body of the text. In Ricoeur, I explain it. The text is very important, but not in the same meaning, because it is the meaning of the text, the sense of the text for me. So it is absolutely not the same meaning than in a Jewish one. But what is the specificity of a Catholic hermeneutic for me? But the specificity of a Catholic hermeneutic, but it can be the same for the Anglicans and so on, which are so close of the Catholics on many, many points, which is to say what? I said that the Catholic hermeneutic is an hermeneutic of body and voice. Not an hermeneutic of text, of the body of the text, not a hermeneutic of the sense of the meaning of the text. It is a hermeneutic of the body and voice. Why the body? Of course, because of the Eucharist. So the Eucharist is first, this is my body, the possibility of adoration, and so on, the body. But why voice? And that is a very important point for me. Because I remember when I wrote this chapter, the first chapter of Crossing the Rubicon, I was thinking myself, but what can I do with the liturgy of the word? Which is not only the liturgy of the Eucharist, and you know we have the two in liturgy. And I said, it is the liturgy of the word, is a liturgy of voice. Why? Because there is no voice without body. So you have no liturgy of the word, independently of a liturgy of the Eucharist. Okay, if you are behind the door, I can hear your voice. But you are behind the door. And if you phone to me, I say hello. And if I know you very well, I don't need to see your name on my phone. Now we see all the names on the phone. But I can say that it is you. Exactly what Jacques Derrida said in his book, The Voice and the Phenomenon, La Voix et le Phénomène. He said that the voice is the phenomena which singularizes the people, because we recognize the people to their voice. Okay, so I remember, just to a point to explain how I wrote the book, I remember I was in Freiburg a very long time ago. I wanted to have my wife with my phone, so I was far away. And she didn't respond to my phone. Oh, you know that. I was leaving the house for 4 days, for a conference. And we have the children at home. Okay. And it was 2 o'clock in the morning. And I wanted just to hear her voice, for saying nothing, but just to hear her voice. And it is at this moment where I understood that this question of voice is so important. So it is important in philosophy for Derrida. But it is so important in theology. It is so important in the New Testament when he said that he is recognized to his voice, everyone. When he, on the cross, he cried, but in fact the Greek, he cried with his big voice. Or Mary Magdala on the garden, she recognized him to his voice. So in that way, if I develop a Catholic hermeneutic of body and voice, you understand first why we have to link the liturgy of the Eucharist and the liturgy of the word first, and second point, that we recognize someone to his voice. And fantastic sentence of Hugues of Saint-Victor, it is in my book, The Book of Experience, which is on the monastic theology, it will be translated. Hugues of Saint-Victor said, the body is, this is an analogy, the body is for the disciple, was for the disciple, exactly what the voice is for us today. Because today, we do not have the flesh of Christ, even resuscitated, you don't see him in flesh, but we always have his voice. What does it mean, his voice? You can recognize that is God, this event is God. So this question is voice is very important for me. Of course, it's not reserved to the Catholics, but it means that if you speak about voice and body, the text will not be first. And last point, it is exactly what Bonaventure said, because Bonaventure in this Breviarium or in his Exaimeron, in his book, he explained, it's fantastic and very Franciscan. I told you that I was a bit Ignatian, but I am Franciscan too. And what said Bonaventure? Bonaventure said, the first book is the book of creation. So, it was possible to see God in the creation. It was possible for Adam and Eva to see God, to sing for God in the creation. But, said Bonaventure, because of the sin, we needed the book of scripture. So I think that in the Catholic tradition, the book of scripture is not first. No sola scriptura. And in fact, you can understand that when you read the Bible, because when Moses goes on the Torah and so on, it's to receive a scripture. But because there was a crisis in the people of Israel. Okay, so then, so first, the first book is the book of creation. We can lower the boy, the God, Lord, for the creation. Because of the sin, we need the book of Scripture. And what do we have now? What do we have to do? Said Bonaventure. We have to come back to the book of creation. So important today, this question, because of the question of climatic crisis, the question of ecology, Laudato Si, of the Pope Francis, and so on. But why do we need the book of Scripture? Because I never said that we don't need it. We need the book of Scripture to come back to the book of Scripture. Why? Because, as said Bonaventure, the Scripture is symbolic. And what is the symbolism in Scripture? As said Bonaventure, at that point he's very close to Ricoeur, he said that in the Scripture, we use of metaphors, the metaphors of things. Or in the New Testament, we use of parables. Oh, why do we need metaphor? For example, if I take the example of a psalm, you read in the psalm, it's complicated to say that in English, all the trees of the champs, of the are clouding in their hands, clapping in their hands. But in fact, we forget that. So you were in the book of creation. It was no complicated to see that all the trees were clapping their hands. But because of the thing, you didn't see it again. See it? So you have to read the psalm to comment, oh yes, I completely forget. It means that for Bonaventure, the word has not been broken. It's not broken because of the sin. It is an hermetical interpretation because it's not broken. But I lost the glasses, or I have no glasses. So it is an hermeneutical way. Because of the sin, the Scripture is the glasses, is the glasses to see God in the creation.
In the same book, Crossing the Rubicon, you want to define some new boundaries between philosophy and theology. Could you explain to us what these consist of? And you are always speaking about the backlash of philosophy on theology. What does that mean?
So, thanks. So it's a good and difficult question. You asked me two questions in one, but that's good. So the first question is a question of the backlash. So what's it in French? Le choc en retour. Le choc en retour de la théologie sur la philosophie. What does it mean, the backlash of theology on philosophy? And it is a very important point for me in Crossing the Rubicon. It is the fact that the phenomenologist has, and the French one, has to stop to give lessons to the theologian. And to the exegesis, okay, you read the phenomenology, and if you read the theology, I will explain to you what you have to do. You have to describe the phenomena, and so on, and so on. But in fact, it's not enough to translate phenomenology in theology. What we always do in French phenomenology, and it is very helpful, huh? I don't criticate, new conceptuality, and it is clear that there is a renew of theology in philosophy, as often in the story of theology too. Huh? Okay, but there are many points where the theology have to change the phenomenology itself. I will just take an example which has been for me so important. On Tertullian, which is in my book God, Flesh and the Other. And what I discover on Tertullian had an impact on what I wrote on Michel Henry. So I explain to you. What said Tertullian at the beginning of Christianity? He said that Christ had a true body. And what is a true body? It is a body with hair like me, with flesh like me, with bones like me. It was against Gnosticism. It was against Valentinism. And to say that the body of Christ is not a non-angel body. It is against the thesis of the Christ as an angel. But when... So it means it is a true body. But what does it mean, body, in phenomenology? In phenomenology, of course, we have the very well-known distinction between body and flesh, which is in UCL, complicate, corpus, and Leib. But what does it mean? It means that since UCL, and Merleau-Ponty too, and even Ricoeur, it's very important, the body is not only the material body, but it is the live body. It means that today we are always speaking about the live body, what we are living in our bodies. So it's very important, okay? So now we don't want to speak about Descartes anymore. Even in medicine, even for the doctor, even for everyone, what is important, it is the live body, okay? But in fact, in theology, what is important? Not only that the Christ have a live body, but that he have a true body. And it has been a question at the end of my book, The Metamorphosis of Finitude, because this book on resurrection, I said at the end, and I was very happy with this idea, I developed it a long time, to say, okay, the Christ resurrected with his live body. Why? At that time, I was only a phenomenologist, as the other phenomenologist, okay, as Henri. Why? Because we are today in our manner to live our body, okay? Passion. So it means that the body is a relationship between the human being. What will resurrect our relationship with our bodies? So it's nice conception, fantastic conception. But just after I published that book, there is a doctor, a neurologist one, a good friend of me, who came often to my course, and he sent me a long letter, and he said, Mr. Falk, you fall exactly in what you are criticized. I said, why? He said, because if we will resurrect only with our live body, what do you do with the body? Oh, it's been complicated. And he had, if it was true what you said, in fact, the body of Christ could stay in the tomb and resurrect with his live body. That's why the next book, The Wedding Feast of the Lamb, about true body and animality, and that book, The Wedding Feast of the Lamb, it is my turn. I publish an interview in French, it's not in English yet, but translated, but it is un tournant, a turn. There is a turn in my work, because at this moment, I understood that it was not possible to stay only on the live body. And then I did a stage in a center of palliative care. And what did I saw? Not only some live body. And even if the doctor was said the most important thing is to speak with the family, in fact, you have true bodies. What I call, in fact, a spirit body. Alors, this is my concept, the spirit body, le corps épandu en français. In fact, I think it is like the butter in English, the spirit butter. But the spirit body, which is between the extended body of Descartes and the live body of Husserl. It means that we have a true body. I explain in The Witty Things of the Land that our body is an animal one. And we have to come back to this question of animality. And that is one of the more important difficulties in theology. Because we don't speak in theology about animality, which is the beginning of the wedding feast of the Lamb. Why? Because we don't do the distinction between animality and bestiality. Animality is a part of ourselves. So there is animality in ourselves, which is passion, drive, pulsion, and so on. And it's not coming from the sin. But the human being, and only him, can fall under of his animality, what I call bestiality. That's why we can say about an animal, in French, sale bête, bad best. When I said that, I don't say bad best in English, but sale bête, it means that I don't like you, because in fact, I do not recognize this part of animality in me. So, this question of animality is very important for me. And I said, so you can criticize, is that even the Christ is an animal on the cross, So you say, hey, what he said, but exactly what Rembrandt show on his pictures, painting on Le Bœuf Écorché, the painting of Rembrandt. It is the same for Bacon, hein? When you see an animal as a cow, hein, as a cow on the painting, on a cross. So, and so what is a spirit body? The spirit body, it is a body which is an animal one, which is a biological one, exactly what I saw when I assist to chirurgical operation, exactly what I saw in palliative care, but it becomes human, because I see it not as an animal. It is my seeing of on the body of the other, which transform the body of the other in the way of in which it is not only an animal, but is human. It's the same for the eros. I think that in pornography, it's only animality or bestiality. But in the true eros, I see the other. Where's the body? There is an organic body, even in the experience of the eros. But I see you as a human. Exactly like the soldat on the cross, when he say the Christ on the cross, he said, this one is the Son of God. He recognized him as the Son of God. So my way is to say, we live in our animality, and living in this animality, it changed humanity with the seeing of the other. And explain, it's exactly what's happened in the Eucharist. Because what is the Eucharist? It is, this is my body too. What we can say between a man and woman. But when I receive the body of Christ, it's not only speaking. It is a Christ who said to me, this is my body. Me also, I assume all your part of animality. I didn't fall in bestiality because I didn't fall in the sin. But you can eat my body to become human, but not only human, because it is Eucharist. So to become human as a son of God, it means that for me, I never developed a sort of humanism in Christianity. Because what is the specificity of Christianity? It is filiation. So, but it transformed myself, you see? So, just to give you a second example, and that is the Wedding Feast of the Lamb. It's so important for me. The beginning of the Wedding Feast of the Lamb, there is a complete turn. Because it begins with the descent in the abyss. So when you compare the question of finitude, the question of suffering in the Guide of Gethsemane for the Holy Friday, the question of finitude for the resurrection for the Holy Sunday, and the question of body and eros for the Holy Saturday, there is a rupture. And why is there a rupture in that book, The Winning Feast of the Lamb? Because it is a descent in the abyss. And to tell you the story, because it's good to know that the books, the book are coming from our life. To tell you the story, I remember that, in fact, I was descending, I was coming in my own abyss. Why? Because when I wrote that book, many people and friends told me, what's happened to you to speak about the descent of the abyss? And my last book, Our Phenomenon, The Extra Phenomenon, is on the trauma. So what's happened to you? So at this moment, I remember, so it was not so great, but at this moment I remember, so I have four children, grandchildren, and I bought a new house, and I didn't sell the old one. And all the people were saying to me, don't worry, you, because my first house was a house from the 17th century. So. But then it didn't happen. I wait 1 week, 2 weeks, 1 month, 2 months, 3 months. And I remember that I said to my spiritual director, said, now I have to write a book on the Holy Thursday, so perhaps I will have to go to the Mass each day. And she told me, it's not sure. it was Ignatian, she was Ignatian. No, it's not sure. So, what's happened? After me, this was so crazy, because you have children, perhaps some people lead that. So many people, in fact, I'm sure I'm not alone. So you bought a new house. You didn't sell the other one. You asked my parents to have some money. Said yes, but if I give you some money now, I have to give you to all your brothers. It's not possible. The bank phoned to me to make a new credit. Oh, you see that? And then what's my spiritual director said, now it's time for your own incarnation. Not only the leaf body, your own incarnation. So at this moment, well, I explain that because I think it's good to know where the books are coming. And this is my personality. I know that all the people are not doing that. But so I remember that I was with my family in the Bretagne, in front of the sea. The weather was absolutely not good. And I was seeing the earth when I was working. And my wife told me, stop to see only the earth. There was a children. I said, shit! And then I come back to my car. It was a tempest. I entered my car. I took my blood note and I wrote, Nietzsche was right. It means that, as I said before, when I read Heidegger, it helped me for this question of anguish of death, but it was not, it didn't help me when I descend in my own abyss. Because in fact, and what I explained in my book, The Extra Phenomenon, my last book, French phenomenology, I said it at the Sorbonne 2 weeks ago, I said, la phénoménologie française, c'est bien quand on va bien. The French phenomenology is good when you are feeling good. So that has no problem. So you can speak about the face of the other, you can speak about the gift, you can speak about your auto-affection, you can speak about liturgy. When you are good, when you feel good, the French phenomenology is perfect. But what's happened when you don't feel good? What's happened? So that is for me a very important point, and why I change a bit. So that's why to come back to your second question. Enfin, there was two questions in your question, but just to conclude the question of the backlash, you understand that theology will change phenomenology, and if the Christ is a true body, but I have to think what is a true body in phenomenology. So that's why my phenomenological concept of spirit body between the extended body and the leaf body is coming, in fact, from the theology. It doesn't mean that it is a theological one, but it only means that it changed. I have to change my phenomenology because of the incarnation of Christ and because of my life. So then, just to conclude on your second question, Janico, the theological French, the French theological of phenomenology. Theological term. So that is also a story, because I remember in 1991, so I was studying theology in Centre-Serre, and the book has been published for school in a very not well-known edition, Edition de l'Éclat, absolutely very small one. I remember that I've been to the library and I asked, perhaps you could buy this text, and that's it. And then there was a conference on this book in the University of Nanterre. So I've been to the conference. Oh, there was Jean-Luc Marion, there was Michel Henry, Janico, not Ricoeur at that time. So, and we were in a very big amphitheater, and we were 30 people. You see that? how it begin? And in fact, nothing happened. Enfin, and what say Michel Henry? It was incredible. Michel Henry said, dear Dominique, Janico, now he died. I do not understand why I am in this book, because it was in 1991. I never wrote about theology, and it's not because I quoted one time Meister Eckhart in The Essence of Manifestation that I am a theologian. No, why do I am with Levinas? Why do I am with Marion? Why do I am Ricoeur and Jean-Louis Chrétien? No, I didn't belong to that. But Janico, he saw before Michel Henry what Michel Henry will become. Because Michel Henry, 5 years after he published I Am the Truth, 3 years after, he published his book on incarnation, and 2 years after, he published his book on the word of Christ. So it's very funny to think that Janico is so before. So that book of Janico is a hard book. And when I read it, and on Marion, who was at this moment my master, it was a correction, like the professor said, it's a contrasense. So I spoke with Jean-Luc, and we told him it's not a manner to write on the board. But a long time after, I think that the tone is not good and so on, but the content is very interesting. Why? Not because of an orthodoxy of phenomenology, because of course you can say that the phenomenology is absolutely not theological. You can explain that in Husserl, in Edean 1, that there is a reduction on God and not a reduction of the ego. So no theology. You can say that Heidegger always revendicates the methodological of atheism. So there is no theology. You can say that. But it's not the question for me. It's not the question of orthodoxy. But the question of Janico is, how is it possible to develop something which is coming from the below and not from the up? And it is where I recognize myself. Because in fact, my generation, can say Renaud Barbaras and other, is a generation of Merleau-Pontienne. Merleau-Ponty is my master. No more Heidegger, and no more Husserl. And you can explain that in the French tradition, you are first the Husserlian phenomenologist. Paul Ricoeur is of course a Husserlian phenomenologist. Michel Roy, absolutely Husserlian, and so on. Then you have the Heideggerian phenomenologist. Heidegger has been discovered by Jean Beaufret, who is the one who received the letter of humanism of Heidegger, and he responds. So Jean-Luc Marion, and the question of ontology, Jean-Luc Marion, Jean-Yves Lacoste, and even Jean-Luc Chrétien, even if it is not the same Heidegger in which, but me, I am Merleau-Pontienne. And Renaud Barbaras is Merleau-Pontienne, even if he doesn't do any theology for his part. So, what does that mean in that way? What is important in Merleau-Ponty? It is not to think in the way of a rupture. There is no rupture between the orders. Exactly what there is in French philology. Jean-Luc Marion was speaking about the rupture between the orders and referring to Pascal. Then the order of the body with the order of the spirit and the order of charity and the order which is below we can see the up and so on. But for me, I'm not Pascalian in that sense, even if I think that it is not a good interpretation of Pascal. Because when you see the text of Pascal, he can say that the order of reason, for example, figure the order of charity. So for me, in Pascal, it is not a philosophical division between the orders. In fact, it is a figuration. The first order can figurate the other one as the two systems. So on that point, I do not develop a phenomenology in the way of rupture. I do not develop a theology in the way of rupture. I do not develop a phenomenology of revelation. I develop a phenomenology of human being transformed by God. So it is absolutely different, not against, but different. And that's why, as I said, I'm close to Thomas Aquinas now.